issues with ocular trauma.
Okay. So I'll be a little brief on this. I'm filling in for Dr. Jignesh Daswala. So medical legal issues in eye are something which are a big, big problem. Most of the patients nowadays, even with trivial trauma, come to us saying that I cannot see. They usually relate their old disease to the new trauma and try to, you know, file a case. And these things are very, very, very common. Yesterday I mentioned one point. I had a patient 20 days post-op coming to me. He had subconjunctival hemorrhage, post-operative cataract. I accidentally mentioned, it was actually quite naive of me, I mentioned severe SCH, severe subconjunctival hemorrhage. And that severe word was what the patient caught. Went back to the old surgeon who had operated for the cataract just 20 days back, and he said, ki you owe me money. Because of you, I'm having a severe SCH. The patient did not understand what is severe SCH, but he just understood the word severe. Fortunately, that old guy, the other surgeon, is a batchmate of mine. He called me up, and then I called the patient back. I counseled him. Things went smoothly. But such small adjectives can cause a lot of trouble. So you have to be really very, very, very precise in whatever you are mentioning. All that we are doing right now will be insignificant if you commit a small error in writing, in documentation. Remember, you will have MLC cases coming in, day out. If you happen to mention one wrong word, it can land you up in a soup. Indian medical system is going the American way. If you have friends in your American system right now, ask them. Every patient that they are saying, every word that they are uttering from their mouth, they are very judicious in doing it.
Every patient is a potential
legal
litigant.
Potential legal litigant, correct, sir. So whatever you are doing right now will have implications or might have implications on your practice 10 years down the line. Another case, simple. Patient had gone, had jumped from the first floor, small baby of 7 years. After that, she landed on her feet and then fell down on her butts. But she started waddling. The GP, general practitioner, MBBS, from a very old reputed college of Bombay, diagnosed her on X-ray saying that she does not have any abnormality, saying that she is normal. She grew up, and this was in 1989. I know this because that guy, the doctor who diagnosed, he was from my father's batch, 72. Now, 1989, the girl grew up in 2005, the waddling continued, pain in the hip joint. She went to an orthopedician. Orthopedician said that slipped epiphyseal head bilaterally, causing secondary osteoarthritis in that young female. Treatment was bilateral hip replacement. She went back to this first GP, who was the family physician, sued him for 1 crore. Finally, out of court settlement of 58 lakhs. He practically had to sell his clinic. He was a practicing GP in a village. Unfortunate, but has happened. Now you can understand that whatever you are doing today, don't think that you're safe. 10 years down the line, you might land up in a soup. Everything that you're mentioning, be very judicious. So I'll just go ahead very fast. Role of an ophthalmologist, provider of first aid, expert opinion needed, or postmortem. These are the three categories in which I've divided my talk. These are the three ways in which we can be involved in the legal process. Patient is alive, how to proceed? If the patient has come to you, decide whether MLC case or not. For a case to be MLC, there should be history of assault, there has to be a foul play, accidents including road traffic accidents. Even if it is an actual accident, it has to be considered MLC. Patient or patient's legal guardian request to register as a MLC. You cannot do it, the policeman has to do it, but you have to inform the policeman. Registration of the patient is absolutely necessary. The famous dialogue from Munna Bhai actually holds very true once you are into your private practice. Now, how to document? Documentation is the most important part. Even if you give first aid, doesn't matter. Even if you are not treating the patient, doesn't matter. The documentation is very important. These are the points which I've mentioned. Most of you know all of the points, but three main points have to be remembered. Identification of the patient is absolutely necessary. You have to take a Xerox copy of, a photocopy of all the identification documents which the patient has provided to you, as well as the relatives, as well as the witness. Second thing, you have to inform the local police officer. You have to note down his docket number, the name of the constable, what time you had informed him. Also, whoever was in charge of the police station at that moment. Because this is what I've faced personally. I had called up the person in the night, police officer. The patient had come to me, did not take first aid because when I was asking too many questions, he got a little irritated. He left. Later on, I had called up the police officer, but later on I came to know that that man had committed a murder. During the scuffle, he had actually sustained injury to his eye, because of which he had developed traumatic hyphema. Luckily, I had noted down the number of the constable. The constable had informed the police officer that this doctor had called. I was safe. Patient's signature or thumb impression along with witness's signature is very necessary. If you don't have the witness along with the patient, you can manage with one of your staff. Before the examination, take a valid consent. Consent is absolutely necessary. Don't touch the patient. You have to take the vision of the patient because many a times it has been noted in literature, patient has got a good vision. Once the doctor has examined, they have come back to say that once the doctor has touched me, I lost my vision. Be very vigilant. These things are there in the literature. If you are oriented and if you read towards these things, you will understand what is happening.
Video consent
is the best thing right now. Always and always note the vision. Trust me, vision is the most important part. Examination steps, same like what we have studied during MBBS. Look at the patient, then touch the patient, then go ahead with the complete examination of the eye and document everything. The type, location, dimension of the wound, presence and absence on foreign bodies, important negative signs as well. Court of law now has individualized the medico-legal cases. It does not follow a rule. It does not follow the old cases. They actually individualize each case now. You have to understand your case will be treated as a unique case. Don't think that you can cite the old judgments and get away with it. Important negative signs also are needed to be entered in your documents now. This is what the latest order says. Classification of the wounds, simple eye injuries, grievous eye injuries. You have the various classification systems. I'm not going into detail. This can be found in any of your ophthalmological books. Again, the classification of the open wounds, closed wounds. Now, expert opinion. The eye is an important organ. You have to understand whether you are an expert or not. Even if you are not an expert, if you have a degree, you will be considered an expert. You may be called upon any time by the court. When you will be called as a third party, when you have treated or examined the patient as an expert or as a legal proceeding against your own self. God forbid that should not happen. When an ophthalmic mishap happens in the hospitals, in the camps, government hospitals, charitable hospitals, you are a private practitioner in the vicinity, you might be called upon. See, these are the places or these are the conditions where you can be summoned by the court. Trust me, any one of us can be summoned. It's usually the top brass who is called upon. You know, Mumbai mein there is Dr. Lahane sir. So he will be called upon. He is already an authority. Everybody knows him. His judgment will be the final authority. But don't think that he would, you know, you would not be summoned. You can also be summoned. So make sure that you have already read all the laws and bylaws which concern the ophthalmic circle. How to opine? Be very precise. Don't use any adjectives. Include your time, date, place of examination. Very, very, very clearly in writing, you have to give it. If you are unsure about your own writing, ask your staff to write it and supervise it. Definitive opinion should not be given unless asked. You should always give differential diagnosis in case it is available. Potential medical legal problems that you might face in your private practice, malingering, which is very common. I'll just wrap up. This is the last slide. Malingering, you have to go ahead, read all the tests which can be done by the general ophthalmologist for ruling out the potential causes of malingering. Second opinion for various diseases. I just gave you an example.